Good morning. Greetings from King George Medical University. Let us quickly go through how to approach a case of spine disease. It is spine disease if there is pain, local or radiating, swelling in spine or elsewhere like a collapsus, deformity, loss of function or movement, or neurological deficit. Whenever you suspect spine disease, think of congenital traumatic inflammatory immune or inflammatory infection, neoplastic, degenerative, metabolic, or miscellaneous. Now that's a common grid that you throw around almost any examination. That is the nature of the problem. A congenital problem of the spine, you have a maximum chance of missing because the child never tells you of any problem, and this should be prevented, and all obstetricians should be taught to look for this. The lamina don't fuse, and that leads to a dimple or a tuft of hair or excessive lumbar lordosis, or you may be able to see it on x-ray. Whenever you see it, you alert your neurosurgeon so that he can do detethering of the nerve roots and impending neurological deficit and complications are prevented. Especially, you may have to cover the spine defect so that there is no meningocele or meningomyelocele. Finally, you must look for hydrocephalus because spina bifida is usually associated with Arnold-Chiari malformation that can lead to hydrocephalus, and that may need a shunt. Then the traumatic. In the traumatic, there is history of injury. There is pain, tenderness, deformity, neurological deficit. But you may not get it in an unconscious patient, and therefore it is wiser to suspect it and prevent neurological deficit rather than miss it. And whenever you have a traumatic spine with or without neurological involvement, you must determine the vertebral level. Then you must examine the sensory and the motor system, determine the level of involvement, determine whether it is upper motor neuron or lower motor neuron, whether it is partial or complete. Then you must look at the bladder involvement. Initially, there is retention. Then there is dribbling urine with post-void residual above 100 cc's. Then there is evacuation in a stream, automatic evacuation in a stream with post-void residual 100 to 50 or less than 50. And finally, you must look for infection, hematuria or fistula, which are the complications of bladder involvement in spinal cord injury. You must then look at bowel involvement, paralytic ileus, skin involvement, pressure sores, you must prevent them. Then motor involvement can cause contractures. Look for comorbidity. In quadriplegia, you must look for respiratory involvement, loss of temperature control because of paralysis of sweat glands, and many other complications which affect these patients, including amyloidosis. The inflammatory immune group. Okay, inflammatory can be immune or infective. In the immune, you have a young male with a HLA-B27 genotype. He has an infection with the peptidoglycans positive organism. The peptidoglycans and the antibody in this individual, which are haptans, produce an immune complex. This immune complex deposits at the ligamentum periosteal junction, causing enthesmopathy, which leads to tenderness, spasm, and which specifically increases in the morning and with cold, wet weather. The ligament calcifies, leading to ankylosis of the spine, the costovertebral joint leading to reduced chest expansion, The sacroiliac joint and the large joints of the lower limb are also involved, usually asymmetrically. Outside the joint, you must always look for uveitis with arthritis, the Ritter syndrome. You must look for ulcerative colitis, which is called as enteropathic arthritis, and you must look for psoriasis, which is psoriatic arthritis. The spine movements can be measured and tested in the early stage by the Schober's test, the cardiovascular movements by chest expansion, the costovertebral movements by the chest expansion. Must also examine the temporomandibular joints, the neck movements, the hip, knee and other joint movements. The deformity is usually in a smooth deformity involving many vertebra, and there is tenderness, and sacroiliac joint tests are positive. In the inflammatory infective group, you have the tuberculosis of the Cox spine with paraplegia. It's called as POTS paraplegia. Here there's a young male or female with poor socioeconomic status, immune compromise, which may be exposed to tuberculosis. There may be evidence of tuberculosis in the family, tuberculosis at other places in the same patient. There may be history of ATT and response to it. There is loss of weight. There is evening rise of temperature. There is pain. There are night cries. There is a positive coin test. And there is an angular tender kyphosis. You must look for matted lymph nodes. You must look for pulmonary tuberculosis or tuberculosis elsewhere, intestine or kidney. You must look for neurological involvement, exactly on the same lines as for spinal cord injury, and you must look for collapses. Then the neoplastic is almost like TB spine, except that the disc space is maintained. You may have the evidence of primary. The multiple myeloma in the elderly can be diagnosed by tenderness elsewhere and Benz-Jones protein in urine and multiple lytic areas in flat bone. Sometimes benign conditions like eosinophilic granuloma can also produce radiological abnormalities in the spine. Now here is the disc. In scooter riders braking and accelerating on bumpy roads, they have a shearing stress on the cervical disc which degenerates and herniates. It causes pain and limitation of movement of the cervical spine. The cervical spine may be tender. Then it presses on the nerve root, causing brachialgia and neurological deficit in the upper limbs. Then it can lead to involvement of the vertebral artery, causing transient ischemic attacks and vertigo. So this is how you examine a case of degenerative cervical spine problem. Then a degenerative lumbar spine problem, which is also called as prolapsed intervertebral disc. Again, scooter riders braking and accelerating on bumpy roads, having shearing stress on the lumbar disc. Obese have a special problem. One day they bend and this precipitates the prolapse. They have acute lumbar pain or sciatic pain and cannot really straighten up from the bent position. If the pain distribution is in the great toe, it is L5-S1, small toe L4-L5. If EHL is lost, L5-S1. If FHL is lost, L4-L5. If ankle jerk is lost, L5-S1. If knee jerk is lost, L4-L5. Bending toward the same side, if that relieves the pain, you have a paracaudal prolapse. If on the opposite side bending relieves the pain, it is a pararedicular prolapse. And of course, one other sign is described with prolapsed intervertebral disc, that is called as the doorbell sign. The metabolic conditions, either osteomalacia or osteoporosis, there is pain, there is tenderness, which is generalized kyphosis, there may be a collapsed vertebra or codfish deformity on X-ray. If alkaline phosphatase is raised and there is multiple idiopathic symmetrical pseudo fractures, then you say osteomalacia, otherwise you say osteoporosis. You may look for signs elsewhere of osteomalacia and osteoporosis. You may do a BMD by DEXA or ultrasound, and fluofer is done by tetracycline fluorescence, and if you have less than 10 fluofers in high power field in the marrow, then that bone is osteoporotic. In the miscellaneous, you have the scoliosis, which is a pathological permanent lateral curvature of spine with rotation. It causes congenital, cause can be congenital, which can be short, sharp curve with Harrington index less than 5, caused by a hemivertebra or a fused vertebra. A paralytic scoliosis has a large curve which has a less angle. Then there can be an idiopathic scoliosis, usually right-sided male thoracic. You must determine the extent of the primary and the secondary curves. You must measure the rib hump. You must determine movements, determine respiratory involvement, determine neurological involvement, determine whether the iliac apophysis status, whether it's fused or not, which would determine the rate of the angle growing, and finally you must determine the angle of the primary curve to decide on to what to do or not to do with the curve. Thank you.